Hello everyone, welcome back to the condensed matter physics class, where today we are going to discuss about thermal evaporation method. In our previous class, we have discussed about the thin film physics introduction part of it. Then we understood what actually are thin films and which are the different deposition processes, that is mainly PVD and CVD. And in PVD, we have the thermal evaporation method which will be dealt today, that is physical vapor deposition method of preparation of thin film. So to understand, let us start with understanding the block diagram, or how is the setup for thermal evaporation method. We know thermal means related to heat, evaporation is nothing but a vaporization, we can say, and using these two parameters, how we are going to deposit a thin film is what we are going to study. So here we can observe there is a vacuum chamber with a crucible where the material which we need to prepare a thin film will be kept, and there is a substrate and a substrate holder on which the thin film will be formed. So let us understand what actually is the procedure that will take place in this method. So here material to be deposited is placed in an inert crucible. Material may be metal or semiconductor, whatever is as per our requirements. So the metal or material will be within the crucible. The condition is that the chamber is evacuated to a pressure of generally 10 raised to minus 6 to 10 raised to minus 7 torr. That is the condition of the system where thin film will be deposited. Then the crucible in which the material is kept, which is the source material, is heated using any aids, like it may be a filament, electron beam, laser, etc., to flash evaporate the material from the crucible, which will then condense onto the substrate. So whatever source is there or whatever material is kept within the crucible, it will be heated by different aids, which will be discussed later. And due to the change in temperature or agitation, that is due to heating, which is nothing but thermal, the source material is evaporated and it will finally condense over the substrate, forming a thin film, because here the temperature is less. That's why the atoms or the molecules which are evaporated will condense over the substrate, forming a thin film of whichever material is required with respect to the application purposes. So this is the brief procedure of thermal evaporation method. We need a inert atmosphere and the source will be heated from the crucible using different methods, due to which evaporation takes place and finally condenses over the substrate, forming a thin film. That's why this type of physical vapor deposition process is termed as thermal evaporation method. So let us understand this in detail. Some points to be remembered, like the advantages. This thermal evaporation method of thin film deposition is used to produce mainly polymeric coatings or even polymeric semiconducting material thin films. So that is the one advantage. Then the films obtained by this method are highly crystalline, and because of their nature, we need not go for any additional annealing process. So these two are the main advantages of thermal evaporation methods. And the evaporation rate is a function of vapor pressure of the metal or the material, which is another important factor to be remembered. And also the source material shape depends on the heating approach. So based on different types of heating approaches, it may be heating using a filament or using an electron beam, whether it is using a laser beam. So based on different types of heating approaches, we will get different quality of the thin film based on the material which we are using. So let us understand different approaches of heating the material which we need to deposit as a thin film. So methods of heating, that is the variants. Mainly there are 7 approaches for heating any material for the thin film deposition by using this method. So let us discuss one by one. First one is the resistive heating process. Whatever procedure we have already seen remains the same, only the approach of heating is going to differ based on which we are having different types of it. So let us understand using a block diagram, and this is the simplest way of heating mainly in the laboratory setups. So here the diagram or the conditions remains the same, that is we need an inert atmosphere, then there is a crucible where the target material is kept, then by heating these material are going to evaporate and they will settle down onto the substrate forming a thin film because of the difference in the temperature, because heating is done only to the crucible and the substrate will be maintained at the lower temperature, that's why condensation takes place. So the only difference is that in resistive heating we are using a filament, so that's why it is called as a resistive heating. So a tungsten filament or a boat is heated, which is used as a containment structure, means it consists of the target material where it will be heated, and it will be generally made up of some refractory metals like molybdenum, tantalum, etc. Here within the crucible we can keep any metal, example aluminium, which will be melted due to the resistive heating, that is due to the filament, and the metal it will just evaporate because of melting, and finally the evaporated or vaporized material will just condense over to the substrate forming a thin film of the material which is present as the target material. For example, it may be aluminium also, and the most materials have very high temperatures, that's why we need to remember that always we cannot melt it just by heating. Thus we need to use some other ways of energizing the atoms so that these can be transported onto the substrate. So that is the limitation of resistive heating. It is the simplest way of heating, no doubt, but the material which are having a very high melting point, if we need the thin film of such material, then by just the resistive heating or heating using the filament, we cannot melt the material. That's why evaporation doesn't take place and thin film also cannot be formed. So because of this type of limitation, we have a second approach of heating, which is an electron beam evaporation method. So from the heading itself we can understand that for heating of the target material we are utilizing the electron beam. It was first used during 1970s by Pratt and Whitney, and again the setup is same, only the difference is that in order to heat the target material we are using a electron beam. So the energy which is consisted in the electron beam will be transferred to the target material, which will evaporate the target material, and finally we get a thin film. So here a focused electron beam is used to locally heat the source. An electron beam is used to heat or evaporate even high melting point materials. So that is a advantage of electron beam evaporation, which overcomes the limitation of resistive heating. Another advantage is that using this method, alloys can also be deposited without dissociation of their constituent elements. If you just heat any alloy using the resistive heating approach, then their composition or the constituents may just separate or dissociate, but when we are using the electron beam approach, then alloys will not be dissociated into constituent elements and thin films of alloys also can be deposited. So that is another important advantage of electron beam evaporation technique, and this is ideally suited for reactive evaporation like oxides, nitrides, etc. So this is the detail of the second approach, where we are using electron beam to heat the target material. Moving to the third approach, that is the evaporation by RF induction or heating. So here the approach is similar to that of the second one, only the difference is that the high intensity electron beam gun having the energy 3 to 20 kilo electron volt is focused onto the target material, that is placed in a copper hearth. and the copper hearth will be water cooled in order to maintain the original nature of the target material and to overcome the dissociation of the target material. The electron beam is magnetically directed onto the evaporant, which will melt locally, and as it is an electron beam, no contamination from the crucible will take place. Means if you use a resistive heating approach, because of heating the crucible, the contaminants can be mixed into the target material and the target material will not be that much pure. But when you are using an electron beam, even if it is a high intensity electron beam, the crucible is not going to react. So that's why the target material will not be contaminated, due to which the advantage is that a high quality film will be obtained. So this is an important advantage of this approach, and the deposition rate is very high, of the range 50 to 500 nanometers per minute. But again, there are some disadvantages of this approach also. The process might induce some X-ray damage or even ion damage at the substrate. And at high energy, let us say greater than 10 kilo electron volt, the incident electron beam causes X-ray emission also. So these things are to be kept in mind, which are acting like a limitations of this approach. And another main thing is that the deposition equipment is more costlier when compared to the previous two. And the first one is very simplest one. That's why we are using it in laboratory setups. Coming to the next type of approach is the flash evaporation. Here, a rapid evaporation of multi-component alloy or a compound which will tend to distill fractionally may be obtained by continuously dropping the fine particles of the material onto the surface, which is hot. And alternatively, a mixture of components in a powder form may be fed into the evaporator. So again, the setup remains the same. Only difference will be with respect to this part. Instead of filament or an electron beam, we are using the flash approach. So here we are just supplying fine particles onto the evaporant, that is crucible, by distilling it fractionally, and simultaneously the evaporation of fine particles will take place, which will finally condense over to the substrate, forming the thin film whichever is required. So the same setup is shown in this diagram for easier understanding. So this is a boat which will be heated so that flash evaporation will take place of the fine particles which are added and simultaneously vaporizing onto the substrate. So again, this method is having its own disadvantage, that is, flash evaporated films show a considerable deviation from the original composition. Because of the distillation which is done fractionally, the original composition of the material which we take and that of the thin film which is deposited will not be always same. There will be some type of variation because the evaporation is not continuous, but it is discontinuous in the form of flashes. And the second disadvantage is that this method is not easily controllable, because the large amount of rapidly released gases produce spattering of the particles from the evaporant. Because of the temperature difference, based on the setup, there will be a large number of gases which will be released within the chamber. And due to the presence of those gases, the vaporized particles are going to be spattered from the evaporant. And that's why we say it is not so easily controllable. And again, we are not going to get any very high quality thin film onto the substrate. So the first disadvantage is very important and it cannot be neglected. So coming to the next approach, that is arc evaporation. So what actually is arc is the question. So again, diagrammatically explaining, system is similar. So the released gases will be pumped out using the vacuum pump so that the process will continue without any restriction. So for evaporation purpose, we are using an arc. So how to get an arc? It is very simple, using some electrodes. So by striking an arc between two electrodes of conducting material, sufficiently high temperatures can be generated. And due to the higher temperature which is produced, the evaporation of the target material, like mainly we are using the refractory metals or materials like niobium or tantalum as a target material, these materials will be evaporated due to the arc and will condense over to the substrate, forming a thin film. So what are the disadvantages? Again, the arc initiated by bringing the electrodes together may last for just approximately 0.1 second, that is 1 by 10th of the second. So when the two electrodes are brought near to each other, an electric arc will be produced which is having a higher energy, due to which there will be production of higher temperature which will evaporate the target material. But this arc is not having a very larger lifetime. The arc will just last for approximately 0.1 second. We can understand how much small time limit we are having for heating the target material. So this is one disadvantage. And the deposition rates of approximately 50 angstrom per second or even higher deposition rates can be obtained for such refractory metals. But again, the process is not so easily reproducible, because arc has to be produced continuously, and again the heating has to continuously take place, due to which evaporation has to take place, and finally condensation, which will be responsible for thin film deposition. But the source of evaporation, which is the electric arc, is not so easily generated, or even if it is generated, it is not going to last long, due to which the reproducibility, that is the repetition of the same process, becomes difficult, which is the main disadvantage of arc evaporation approach. So moving to the next approach, that is exploding wire technique. So wire is again related to resistance. Exploding wire, what does it mean? Whether it is related to again the first approach, resistive heating, or something else, let us see. So here, this method consists of exploding a wire by a sudden resistive heating of a wire with a transient high current density approaching 10 raised to 6 ampere per centimeter square. So here the wire itself is resistively heated with a very high current density, due to which the explosion in the wire will take place. That's why the name exploding wire technique is given. But how to achieve it is a question. So this is achieved by discharging a bank of condensers with a capacitance approximately ranging from 10 to 100 microfarad, will be charged to a voltage approximately from 1 to 10 kilovolts through a metallic wire. And because of this high range, there will be a catastrophic destruction and vaporization of wire at some region within it. So due to this destruction, there will be again rise in temperature, which is going to evaporate the target material, finally leading to the deposition of thin film. So this is another approach, but still again it is having its own disadvantage, that is the thin films formed shows the regions of defect due to the condensation of microparticles which are spattered during the explosion. So explosion is something like a disaster. And when a disaster takes place, the conditions or the situation in the environment or the surroundings are going to be adversely affected. In the same way, when the wire is exploded, because of the high voltage, the quality of the film will be disturbed and there will be some regions with some defects. So this is the limitation of exploding wire technique, which will lead us to the next approach, which is laser evaporation technique. So from the heading we can understand there is a laser source involved in this procedure. So here we are using a pulsed laser beam to evaporate the target material. So the enormous intensity of the laser may be used to heat and vaporize the materials by keeping the laser source outside the vacuum system and focusing the beam onto the surface of the material to be evaporated. So again the same thing, heating is done just by using a high intensity laser beam. And again the disadvantage is that only surfacial evaporation is going to take place, because the laser penetration depth is small, of the range 100 angstrom, because of which the evaporation will take place only at the surfaces. So the laser is not going to be penetrated within the target material to a higher depth. So only the atoms or molecules or ions which are present on the surface of the target material, that is in the crucible, will be evaporated, forming the thin film onto the substrate. So this is the limitation of laser evaporation method, and these are the main 7 approaches or methods of heating the target material for deposition of thin film using thermal evaporation method, that is the type of physical vapor deposition process. So we have seen that even if we study all the 7 approaches of heating, which is a PVD technique, still each and every technique is having its own disadvantages. And due to all these disadvantages, we come up with the next deposition process, which is a chemical vapor deposition technique, which is termed as CVD. And CVD technique will be dealt in detail in our next class of condensed matter physics. And this is about the thermal evaporation method of thin film deposition. So see you in our next class. Till then, study well, stay safe. Thank you.